Okay, welcome back to this next bit. Okay, so it's no secret we love a bit of nepotism on this podcast. So today we've organized a real doozy for you. For Aussie and international, millennials and Gen Z alike, there was one defining Australian TV program of our childhood and tween years that stayed with us like no other. A show about three regular girls from the Gold Coast that become mermaids took the world by storm. And as it celebrates its 15-year anniversary for this year, it has somehow never been more relevant. We are, of course, talking about H2O Just Add Water. And here to talk about all things H2O today to celebrate the anniversary, the original executive producer, creator of the concept, and my mother, Kay Lawrence.
Woo!
Or for the fact checkers, at the time, Kay Benmorad.
Correct.
Welcome to the Second Estate.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I'm a big fan.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Hannah, do you want to kick off the first question with her?
I'll get going. So to start off, Kay, can you tell us or describe to us what your role was in creating H2O, just so people can understand what an executive producer does?
Executive producers can kind of take on a few different roles, but my role was I worked permanently in the company with Jonathan Schiff, and we were producing children's drama, you know, live action children's drama. We had ongoing relationships with Network 10 in Australia and ZDF in Germany, who's the big public broadcaster there, and we were delivering them a show a year, basically 26 half hours. We had to come up with a new concept. We'd finished with the series we'd done before and they were looking for a new concept from us. And so part of my role was to, I did all the business side of things, so, and the marketing. And so I needed to know what the market was looking for. And whilst we always tried to appeal to girls and boys, the fact is most live action drama was skewed towards girls. So you'll find in everything that we did, it had probably a little bit more of a girl focus because boys watched animation, girls watched live action. Of course, there's crossover and there's lots of different tastes, but generally that's how it is. So we'd come up with a bit of a boy-led series, and our partners, our network partners, it wasn't quite working for them. And so part of my job was basically to convey that back to Jonathan, who was the creative producer and executive producer. And he'd come up with a concept, which I think's now been developed more into a series more recently called Mako Island. And it was about a boy and a pet shark. But it just wasn't sort of doing it for the market. And so I needed to, you know, we needed to come up with something else. We were doing brainstorming sessions. And my job is obviously to make sure this gets across the line, that we get into production. So I'm kind of giving you two things at the same time. I'm telling you the background of how we got to H2O and my role. So I hope that's okay.
No, that's all.
Yeah, it just makes it easier for me. So I'd actually been reading a story to my daughters, Sarah being one of them, about a girl who becomes a mermaid. She doesn't know she's a mermaid and becomes a mermaid. So I felt that was kind of an interesting thing that we could perhaps put into a series. And I went into the office and basically pitched it to Jonathan, and we worked it up with a team and came up with H2O. The thing is with mermaids, it's just universal. When I was a kid, I played mermaids in the swimming pool. You know, it's just something kids love. We always did a fantasy. All our children's production had a fantasy element to it, so it just fitted really well. So then we worked that up. As executive producer, I don't have a lot to do with getting it from an idea into sort of something we can pitch to the networks, but then I need to go and pitch it. So it got worked out. We had Jeffrey Walker, who became one of the directors. He was involved in as well. And just we had our usual team of story editors and writers.
Sorry to interrupt, but he's an actor now, isn't he?
No, no, he was an actor, and now he's a director.
Now he's a director. That's
So he was a child actor. He started in Round the Twist years and years ago. I think Round the Twist, yeah. And then we had him in a lot of the series we did, Ocean Girl, Thunderstone. He was a great actor. And then as he got older, he wanted to move into directing. And now he does. He directs a lot. And he does feature films. He's a great director and a lovely guy. And so he was part of that team too. And they developed a great concept then with these three girls, accidentally becoming mermaids and all that goes with that. And so I then pitched that to the networks. They loved it, absolutely loved it, snapped it up, and in we go. So then it's my job to budget it, to then sort of oversee the every aspect, I suppose, with Jonathan, the other executive producer, every aspect of the series. I didn't have as much to do with the creative as Jonathan would, because that's his shtick, and was more in the business side of things. But I still was involved in casting of the girls, casting of senior crew, things like that, and then along the way, I have to make sure that we're getting it made on budget, on time, that it can be delivered to the network, that, it's just an executive producer in Australia, in the role that I had, has a fairly hands-on job. If you're in the US, an executive producer could be your cousin's nephew who wants a credit and doesn't even get paid. So executive producer in the States.
That's why actors are so often.
Yeah. I have often wondered.
Whereas in Australia, an executive producer has a real role and an important role. So that's that.
Continuing on then, you talking about how you were involved in the casting of the girls, because they've, particularly two of them have gone on to quite big careers, especially for like teen Australian actors. Yeah. It's not, other than Margot Robbie, it's not that it's not that common. I was just sort of wondering, we were both wondering what the casting process was like with those three, how you came to the decision to pick those three actresses or, whatever.
So I'm not involved in the early stages when we had a casting agent, and they basically, do a call out, go to all the casting agents, managers, get a whole lot of girls. It gets to a short list. And then when we get to that short list, then the director's involved a little bit earlier, but then it starts to get quite difficult. You actually need someone else to come in with a bit of a fresh eye, and that's where I could come in because I hadn't been part of the process to that date. So, yeah, casting for everything is the same unless you've got a person in mind for a role,
Did you have any of the girls before?
No, we didn't. But there were some girls that we were looking for and looking at, but they weren't available, they weren't interested. And one of them was, and I'm sorry, I should have researched her name. She's a really well-known Australian actress now. She was in Lemony Snicket.
Or Emily.
Emma?
Do you remember?
Emily Brown. Brown.
No,
she was going to be Bella in Twilight. Is that the actress?
Maybe she's got a really, I'm really sorry, I can't remember, but I think she was.
I know who you're talking about.
I think she was up for an international role. And so we went a little bit down the path with her, but then she wasn't available. So these girls weren't, I'm trying to remember, it's a long time ago, whether any of them, some of them I think hadn't really done anything at all. They were all pretty green and pretty new and just at school and maybe done bits and pieces here and there. So I think we had about five or six, not many shortlisted, like just a few. And there was a little bit of difference of opinion as to how we picked the three girls. Now, we've got to remember this is a long time ago and the world was less inclusive. So it's a little bit unrealistic, this isn't what everyone. And so I think the changes now have been fantastic. And I don't necessarily think that was the right way that's the way the world was, so we wanted three lovely girls, three girls that felt like they could be your next door neighbor, but kind of girl special quality, I suppose. They're the quintessential girl next door, but
except for Ricky, the bad girl.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's just a look, that's, I guess, the diversity that we had in it, you know, the single parent.
The tomboy.
The tomboy.
No, I think that's about just, yeah, look, that's
Leo was vaguely ethnic looking, so that would do.
No, she wasn't picked for that. It was just they look different but similar, I suppose. They do all look different, but they just all look like Australian girls, I suppose. Yeah. Which again was important because in the international market, the appeal for our programming was because it did feel Australian. And you know, that was an important part of it. So but yeah, look, in hindsight, it's a shame that it wasn't a more diverse cast, but we were casting for the time, and for the time it was perfect. So yeah, that five or six girls, we sort of basically sat in a room and had, I think at Jonathan's apartment and in Main Beach, because we were shooting it all up on the Gold Coast, and just, you know, watched their auditions over and over and really just narrowed them down and felt that the three of them, not only because really once you get down to sort of six or seven, they're all going to be great performers. Mm. They're all going to be right for the role. It's just a matter of, you know, putting those three together, how they look together, because you're going to see them on a poster together. You're going to, you know, and we had it also, of course, had an idea of what these characters were going to be. So you want a look to match the character, I suppose, is, you know, and, but you do a bit of that with hair and makeup as well. And wardrobe obviously is really important in terms of making that performer, you know, fit with the character in the end. So yeah, that's how we came up with them. Basically just looking at them all, taking one out, putting one in, putting them together on a screen just until we sort of got it right.
I think what you said about it being them feeling Australian and it being like a very Australian sort of production kind of leads into the next question we had. But this show was very transformative, or just very popular with young people. Like, I remember being a kid and having a pool, and me and my friends would play H2O just in water, and you'd choose.
Who were you?
I was Emma.
Yeah.
But you choose, if anyone was wondering, but you choose who you would be, kind of thing. But it's so interesting because this show was, and I didn't know this when I was a kid, but it was obviously such an international success as well, despite being such an Australian show. So did you expect it to be the success that it was?
Yeah, in a way, yes, because we had been doing that for quite a few years. It's really interesting. One of the first series that we did that was very successful was a series called Ocean Girl. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, similar girl and water, but different, because Ocean Girl
is really an archetype. Yeah,
you really have a niche.
Yeah, it was. So that was four series. We shot that up in far north Queensland and on the Barrier Reef, and that had sold to 110 territories, to 110 countries. So we knew that there was an appetite. And for Australian programming, I can remember being in London, pouring rain, miserable grey day. We put Ocean Girl on the screens with her buyer, trying to think, it might have been BBC. And on that grey, miserable day in London, seeing those beautiful shots of far north Queensland, sold the series. You can see what the appeal is. So we wanted to keep that going because we understood how to the rest of the world that really iconic Australian look, or especially, and that the lifestyle that we have and everything is really appealing to the rest of the world. So we hoped it would be successful. I guess we were going, you know, we were looking at going back to see what made Ocean Girl so successful. We'd done a lot of series in the meantime, some, you know, and all moderately successful, but I guess we were looking for something that would replicate what we had with Ocean Girl, which was those beautiful visuals. And I think we were able to do that again with H2O. So we were fairly confident. And from the start, we took a very different approach in terms of the marketing. You know, we actually had product in Target, like H2O merchandise. Yeah.
I never got my hands on that. So
sorry.
Weird.
we took a global view to see what we could do in terms of that merchandise and marketing side of it that we hadn't looked at really before for previous series.
Right. I'm going to, sorry, jump on one of your questions here, Hannah, but did you think that, you know, given it was obviously successful back in 2006, when it's 15 years ago, would you ever have expected it to have like the renaissance that it has had in the last couple of years?
Well, actually, what's interesting is children's drama like that has about a 20-year shelf life.
What do you mean?
So people keep watching it for year and year and year and year.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So it isn't like that type of drama, that sort of high-quality fantasy children's drama. I mean, it dates in a way, but you could sit and watch probably anything that we've made from, you know, 1992, and a lot of that would still, because it's got that fantasy element, it's always watchable, I suppose. It's like,
yeah, right.
it's like Disney. Disney have always had that philosophy, and you can watch, you know, Snow White from the 1930s, and it's still great to watch it now. They haven't made a new Snow White animation because they don't need to, because it stands up even now. So I guess I'm not surprised, because I would feel that it would find a new audience. Eventually it won't, but it's great. I think it's fun.
Have you seen all the TikToks about it?
Not really. I've seen a few. I'm not a TikTok fan.
That's fair enough. No,
seen a few, and they're pretty funny. Sarah has definitely sent me some. So
that's,
yeah,
I feel like, been part of the renaissance, sure, if you will, of people who watched it when they were young. Kind of replicating those
recreating scenes,
the things that we sort of that we've kind of forgotten about as kids, like the
Cleo.
Emma. Like Americans putting on the Australian accent, so it's
no, it's I think was one of the big, or the almost the first massive sort of trend on TikTok, when TikTok sort of started to become TikTok. I think it was one of the big. It's still, it's like, you still see a few around for sure, but it was
that was
big.
Definitely, there was just a period of time when everyone was just, heard like Cleo.
Cleo, Emma.
I'm fairly sure it's like, it's on Netflix now.
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
So we're just going to kind of ask you about the show itself, things that happen within the show. And I don't know if you just want to explain quickly where you guys filmed, because people familiar with the show will know that Cleo worked at SeaWorld. And maybe you kind of want to explain like how it was filmed, and maybe also the tail sequences, like how you guys did that, because I feel like that was quite an involved process.
Yeah, so we filmed at the Gold Coast. We filmed at Movie World Studios, the studio components. And underwater, there was a pool there, like a pool set. But a lot of the bedrooms and things were sets, and they were in Movie World Studios on the Gold Coast in Queensland. And then all the locations were shot around the Gold Coast as well, the cafe, the beaches, all of that. As you said, Ricky worked at SeaWorld,
Cleo worked at SeaWorld.
Oh. Did she?
Yeah, Cleo worked at like the food stand.
She did too. Sorry, didn't she? Ricky worked there.
Ricky was just busy being a punk rocker, stealing boats.
I told you it was a long time ago.
No, Ricky did something.
Did Ricky work at the juice bar?
Thought Ricky might have, like, what about Lewis? Didn't Lewis
was like a scientist or something?
Yeah, a teenage scientist. But didn't Ricky didn't become involved in that?
Yeah, Lewis helped out. He was working at SeaWorld as well, but in the marine animal section. Well, the shop there anyway.
What, a 15-year-old marine biologist?
How
old were they meant to be? 16?
16.
Yeah,
yeah, right. Okay.
16 for every series.
Yeah.
They never age.
Yeah.
15,
and the tails,
16.
Do you want to explain the tails?
So the tails, we actually had them made. They were made on the Gold Coast, and they are, for the first series. I'm not sure for subsequent series if they still use the tails or they use CGI or anything. And, of course, CGI was around then, but not in the sophisticated way you would be able to do something now. So those tails were manufactured. And, you know, I can't remember all the details. It's such a long time ago. But I'm trying to remember the name of the company there that did it, that they'd worked on a lot of big US series like Flipper, that had been there years ago, which is a dolphin series, not the original Flipper. There was a reboot. So they were pretty good at doing animatronic, you know.
Yeah.
So basically,
did they kick them themselves? Like, were the tails just big, heavy things, and the girls had to kick
them? Very
tails?
Big, very heavy, very difficult to swim in. The girls had to have swimming training to be strong enough, because those tails were pretty heavy. They were as light as they could be, but they were very, I mean, you could see the size of them and the bulk of them. So they made them easy to manipulate and wear as possible, but they were still pretty heavy. And obviously we always have had safety around just to make sure, because it was difficult to move in them.
Yeah.
I think it adds the tails without them being CGI. Yeah. Add a bit.
It made it feel real. Like,
totally. Because you can always see.
I think they were beautiful and beautifully done and, you know.
And unique. Like you haven't, I feel like I haven't seen mermaid tails. Like the ones in H2O.
I just wanted to ask because this, like I was watching some clips from another Australian series, The Wedge, and they had their own original theme song from this is around the same time that it came out. And I just wanted to ask, H2O obviously has No Ordinary Girl, which I believe was
iconic song.
an original theme song.
It was made for the show, yeah.
Why don't they make shows in Australia with original theme songs anymore?
That's a really good question. And for us, it was part of this, what I was talking about. We were trying to create a brand from a marketing point of view as well. And so that was one of the things we wanted to do, was to have a theme song. And we commissioned a young Australian songwriter to do it. I can't remember her name. But I don't know. That's a good question. But it worked. But I guess it just worked. It was a great song.
Yeah.
I remember. I don't know why people don't do it. It costs money, you know, but it's not. Those days of those children's series with the big budgets and all the things we could do kind of are gone.
Yeah.
So I guess, you know, producers have to spend the money where it's going to be seen on screen rather than perhaps investing in something like that. I don't know why people don't do it.
A fun tidbit for the listeners at home is I remember very clearly seeing an early cut of the title sequence where No Ordinary Girl happens, and it was originally set before the song was ready to the Hilary Duff song Supergirl. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
I remember I got really upset when you said it wouldn't be the actual song, because I loved Hilary Duff, because obviously I was like,
I think we felt it had the sort of the kind of feel that we wanted for whatever the theme song. So it was just we had to do something until we had the song.
Yeah, that was just a fun fact for everybody.
Maybe we can make an edit where we'll just edit Supergirl over the title sequence.
I'm Supergirl, like something like that. You would know it if you heard it. Yeah, it was obviously.
So just in terms of the concept about like the girls and their transformation, touching water, transforming into a mermaid, what was the main thing that kind of confused you or you took issue with about the concept?
For me, I guess I would have liked if we just stuck to when they were in seawater, because for me, I always felt it was a little like, how were they washing themselves? And how are they, you know, but look, it's a fantasy, like they're mermaids anyway, it's not real. So I guess you can't delve too much into that. I kept worrying about how dirty they would be.
Yeah.
You know, how did they clean their lower half?
Yeah, because I remember seeing a scene.
Every time they got into water, they got a tail. So
right,
I was
how they clean their legs, right?
And the rest of it.
And the rest, anything from the waist down. And so that, but you know
it's
what?
True.
You can't think about that or worry about that, because it's a fantasy anyway. And so if you worry too much about those little things, I mean, that's the way they wanted to do it creatively. That's the way. And look, it made for a lot of fun moments, I guess. You know, if it had just been seawater, you wouldn't have had all that thing with the pool and the shower and all those fun moments that were created throughout the series. So I think in the end it was the right decision, definitely. But I used to worry a lot about their lower half.
I guess that kind of answered it. But the question that everybody wants to know about H2O Just Add Water is, why didn't they turn into mermaids when they would sweat?
I have no answer. It was never discussed.
Fair enough.
That actually was never discussed. Girls don't sweat.
That's true.
True.
Yeah.
We never discussed it. You know what? If you started talking about all those things, you'd go down a rabbit hole and never get out.
So in the plot.
We just made a decision that you just don't worry about any of that. We use it to our advantage for storytelling.
You just suspend disbelief.
Yeah.
Correct. They're mermaids after all.
Yeah, you're already doing it.
You're already doing it.
So Who was your favorite character out of the three girls?
Oh, I think Cleo.
Really?
Yeah.
What about her fringe?
That was a deliberate decision to just have them look a bit different.
Oh, well, okay.
Ricky had the same fringe.
I think Ricky had a fringe. It was just a particularly curled, bouncy.
Well, I guess that's because fringe. She's got that sort of hair. You know, she's got a natural curl in her hair, maybe. So, you know, there wasn't much we could do. But, you know, you can see that they've each got a different look. Phoebe was more of that sort of, you know, boho look. And, you know, they just, and that was part of her look.
She wore like cropped cardigans over a singlet and like denim shorts.
Oh, God.
But we didn't have boho then. It had a different.
Yeah, I guess so. But, okay, one more question just about the show itself is what was. Whose idea was the full moon thing and them going with, like, a bit horny in the full moon?
They weren't horny.
scene with Emma and her, the guy she would swim with?
The full moon was the device by which, obviously, hits the moon pool, they become mermaids. So the full moon just becomes another story device that you can use to create situations, I suppose. I don't remember who exactly came up with the moon pool and the moon. And you have to come up with the way they became mermaids. And then I guess you use that moon thing as a recurring device throughout the series to create stories.
Yeah, fair enough. Do you want to ask anything else about the actual show before we move on?
Nah, I think we've
answered
a lot of them.
I just wanted to ask you just about kids TV. You touched on this a little bit, but... Mm-hmm. I think very publicly, people might not know, but the Australian government has just been progressively giving less and less money towards kids TV, and networks are having less and less obligation to show kids TV in Australia now. Streaming services, I don't think, have any obligation to have Australian kids content. So
they don't have any obligation for any Australian content.
Right. So all that sort of considered, do you think we'll ever see live action kids TV with this kind of budget again?
Only on the ABC. So the ABC probably will be able to do one series a year. But, you know, back when we were doing all these fabulous shows that we did, there were lots of other producers also doing them all over the country because the environment was, you know, the funding environment was really good. There is a huge interest in Australian kids drama internationally, but to get the money up front to make it is very, very difficult. So without the government funding here, I mean, the government funding still exists, but you can't get the trigger funding from the network. So the way it works is the government will give you a certain percentage, but you need a particular level of license fee from a network in Australia. The ABC is the only one doing that really anymore, because the only reason the free-to-airs really did it was because they had an obligation to broadcast a certain number of hours of first-run C drama. C is children's drama and comes with a lot of rules and regulations, particularly around advertising. You can't have product placement, all those sorts of things. And the networks didn't like, as soon as they were able to get rid of it, they pretty much got rid of it.
Was that just a legislative change, or was it because of the move towards streaming? Or do you
I think it was a lot of things. Streaming's got a lot to do with it, but also the COVID situation. The networks used that to reduce their obligation on all Australian, saying they wouldn't be able to meet it because of the restrictions, etc., etc. And then I think what's happened is they've been able to get rid of the seed. They've because what they would do is they would allow maybe half an hour once a week to show a children's drama series. So kids can't find that. They can't find it. They didn't promote it. So it was kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy that kids wouldn't watch it because they couldn't find it. So the ABC have dedicated kids channels, the streaming services do, as you know, you've got streamers who are kids. They were always, you know. So the problem is kids weren't watching these shows on the free-to-air channels when they got their first run, because the channels weren't promoting them and they were only putting one or two shows on. So there's not a block of TV for the kids. So it was just this self-fulfilling prophecy. They were saying, look, there's only so many kids watching this. But what I guess everyone failed to understand, including the government, is where is Australian children going to hear Australian voices and see Australians and see Australia in kids' TV if there's not some support from the government and some impetus for networks or somebody to broadcast it? So if the streamers, if it gets to the point where the international streamers have some obligation towards Australian content, then let's hope that kids becomes part of that, because there was an amazing boom of quality kids TV here in sort of the 90s and the 2000s that I'm not sure we'll see again unless we can come up with a different model and there's still some sort of support.
Yeah, that's so sad.
It is sad.
It is sad. It's a real shame. Yeah.
Just to sort of wrap up our questions, you know, I think when you think of big kids shows or defining kids shows over the years that people remember, like probably for your generation, it would be like the Brady Bunch or the Partridge Family, things that we have like heard of as well. And our time is probably Lizzie McGuire, Hannah Montana. But I would say H2O is also, particularly for Australian kids, is in that list. Is that a big feat for like a small, what is essentially a small Australian production?
I guess it is. But, you know, as I said to you guys, at the time, Australian children's TV was pretty successful around the world. And I think what you're talking about more is success in the US, because that's where, you know, and we'd had a lot of success with Ocean Girl in the US. Not our other series hadn't played there, I don't think. Maybe one of them had. So the US market was always hard, always hard. We might sell to 109 territories but not get the US. You know, everywhere else in the world was taking the programming. So I think specifically for an Australian series to be so successful in the US, it's fabulous. It's only a handful you could probably count that have had that sort of success, that if you stopped, someone your age in the street in the US and said, oh, do you know any Australian kids series? It's probably the only one they're going to name.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, it is cool.
All right. Well, thank you for answering our questions about H2O.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it. I think the listeners will appreciate it too. Now we're going to play one of our closing segments that we do every episode. We're going to do How Much Would I Have to Pay You?
Okay.
So are you ready? do you want to go first?
Sure. Okay. So how much would I have to pay you, Kay, if every time you ate lunch – you made that you were making around other people, like in the office, at home, etc. It had to be tinned fish, and you had to and you had to eat it directly out of the tin standing up.
Oh, for like forever, or
yeah, I guess as like long as you're going to the office, you're standing up eating a tin of tuna,
and it's anytime you're eating in front of other people. So when you're not eating in front of other people, or maybe when you're at a restaurant, obviously,
it's not you bring from home lunch at a restaurant.
No, like if you're a restaurant, you can eat normal, but if you're eating in front of people at home or in the office, your tin fish standing up, fork in mouth.
It wouldn't really bother me at all. I just get sick of eating tinned fish.
But you don't eat fish.
Tuna I eat.
Okay, so how much – and tuna smells.
Yeah,
so
it's so awkward.
How much
people eat tuna in the office all the time. That wouldn't worry me. I just wouldn't – like, I mean, so obviously –
So $10?
No, because I'd want to be paid something because I just get sick of eating tuna.
Okay, well, what's the
price? Rest of your life.
Is it the rest of my life?
Yeah.
Like $1 million?
Okay.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
Clearly bothers you a little bit.
Sick of eating tuna every day.
Fair enough. So would I.
Okay, how much would I have to pay you to go back and live in Tunisia for 5 years?
20 million. Only because I'm old. I don't want to waste 5 years living there.
That's just for context. That's where my dad is from. If anyone's wondering why, it's Tunisia. All right, go ahead.
Will I do that one?
Second one, yeah.
Yeah. How much would I have to pay you to get a Can I Speak to the Manager haircut? So that's
what
the
is
like.
That?
It's like the Karen, short, really short.
Side fringe short, Like concave at the front?
$100 million. I'm not cutting my hair. $100 million. Fair enough.
That would be a haircut like that is a real commitment.
Yeah.
And potentially.
I know what you mean now, no. $100 million.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. How much would I have to pay you to not comment if I walked into the house and had a piercing anywhere other than my ears? You can't say anything.
Ever.
Like, I have an eyebrow piercing. You cannot.
And you can
say
never
anything.
Comment on it.
Well, you know, it's your life, 10,000.
You still need something out of it.
Like it's obviously challenging enough that you need 10,000.
It would be hard not to even what if I said it's fabulous? Oh, I love that piercing.
It's very funny.
Fair enough.
All right. The final one is, how much would I have to pay you to be an executive producer for 1 year on Sexy Beasts?
Oh, I don't know whatever the normal going rate is. Like, I wouldn't mind doing that.
Really? You hated it when we watched
I've been doing the same thing for a long time. I quite like the idea of doing something different.
Maybe you could make it better.
Just the normal rate, you know.
Just a normal salary.
Yeah.
Oh, well, there you go.
I guess you could have
money.
A...
I just would...
You could make the show better as well. Having
yeah,
some
I think that would be fun to work on something as, you know, bad. Interesting as that. No, I'd be happy to do that for the normal AP rate. No worries.
All right, cool.
Great.
Sexy right. Beasts, you know where to... We'll drop your contact details below.
Put it in the show notes.
The show notes.
If they want to get in contact.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Kay.
On the episode this week. Great to chat about H2O. Great to know your thoughts on haircuts and tinned fish.
No offense to any of my friends who've got that haircut either. Oh, yeah. Just not my style.
Yeah. I think it's their fault if they have that.
Made the bed, you got to lie in it.
I don't. How do you do that whole thing? Actually?
Is it gelled? Maybe because your hair
must
doesn't naturally grow down.
Sounds like a lot of work.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I would agree.
And I think they get it because it's less work, but it's not.
No, it couldn't possibly.
Because
be
personality automatically just switches as well as soon as you get it. No. Anyway, all right. Thank you everybody for listening to the episode. We appreciate you all.
Follow us on Instagram. Comment stuff. Comment. On the new Instagram post.
No Ordinary Girl.
No Ordinary Girl. That's what I was thinking. Yeah. So, thank you, Kay.
Thank you.
All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye.